Time now for the latest news on what's hot and what's not in the world of technology with Matthew Dickerson on Tech Talk here on TCFM 88.9.
Morning, champion.
I often say that you play songs appropriate for me when I come in, but it would have been a bit egotistical for me to think that that song was around me, so I wasn't going to go there, but you have.
Yes, I thought I'd do it for you.
Thank you.
Indeed. Have you got anything to say before we do Tech Talk this morning? And that is a broad hint.
I think you're looking fantastic. It's great to be out of lockdown. And let's talk Tech Talk.
No. I was hoping for something else. Doesn't matter. All right. folks, now, a water tablet. Now, you've been telling people, or you're going to tell people about this hydrogel water tablet. And reading your notes, I'm thinking, well, why for overseas people? People here have got bore water. They could use it as well.
It could be used anywhere. The big issue here is there's about a third of the world that doesn't have access to clean drinking water. Obviously, in Australia, we're very lucky. We've got great drinking water here in Dubbo, for example, and most places around Australia. You've got easy access to good drinking water. We're a very developed nation, but there are many nations around the world, many areas around the world that don't. They've tried to develop ways to get clean drinking water. We've talked about some of those methods before on this segment. But most of those involve, some involve the sun only, but most of those involve some power. And most of these countries that don't have clean drinking water also don't have easy access to power. This hydrogel tablet, being developed in the University of Texas, is essentially a way to sterilise water, get rid of the germs out of it, basically get rid of 99.999% of all the germs, of all the bad guys in the water, to basically clean up drinking water. Now, you can't drop it into some sewage and then go, oh, I'll drink that an hour later. No. It's designed to take, for example, bore water, as you suggested, or river water, water that's basically clean, but it's probably got some little microbes or some germs in there. One little tablet is designed to do 1 litre of water. It takes about an hour. You drop that in there, leave it for an hour, and then you can drink it. The great part about it is it can scale up. So these tablets can be made either as larger tablets or multiple tablets, and then you can scale up as large as you like and ship out container loads to places that don't have clean access to clean water, access to clean drinking water. And you could then have those people in a village, for example, get water from the river, bring it up, drop a tablet in that ratio, one tablet per litre, and wait an hour and then drink it. So it's a fantastic way to get that out there. I would think that here in Australia, when we've got easy access to power and other ways to sterilise that, it probably wouldn't be sensible to use it because we've got other methods. But in places that don't have those other methods, then fantastic.
Yeah, you could use ultraviolet light, for instance, here, as we do with the council water supply here anyway.
Yeah, lots of things we can do here to do it. But yes, it would still work. But it really seems to me is if you just have a village without easy access to power or ways to clean that water up, drop a tablet in and drink the water.
Great idea. All right, here we go. Solar power headphones. And you knew I was going to ask that one. Solar power cans. What happens there? Do we have to wander around with a plate on our head?
Just carry around a couple of metres above our head.
Yeah, exactly.
The interesting part here is that wireless headphones are obviously fantastic, but they have a battery. And Murphy's Law says when you pick it up to go and listen to some music or use those headphones, of course the battery's flat, you plug them in, wait for a while, charge up, all very frustrating. I'm looking at the headphones that you're wearing right now, and there's a fairly wide band on those headphones because it's more comfortable across the top of your head. So one particular company has built solar panels into that band. Now you think, what a waste of time. I'm sitting here inside at the moment. I've got no access to the sun, but we're looking through a window. There's enough sun coming through that window that you could sit those headphones in the window and that would charge them up. Well, you're not wearing them, obviously, but if you went for a walk outside, there's enough sun most parts of the day, maybe not early morning, late at night, but most parts of the day, there would be more power generated than you would use listening to music. Because listening to music doesn't create a huge amount of power draw on headphones. Obviously, you put a couple of AA or AAA batteries in or a rechargeable battery, it lasts for a fair length of time. So these solar panels are designed to get to the point where you have an infinite battery because you go outside every now and again, you use them, you put them in the windowsill at your home, charges up, you don't have to worry about plugging them in ever. They have got a plug on them still if you ever need to, but you could actually use these in an environment where you never have to plug them in. I think it sounds fantastic.
Great idea, except I wouldn't be using these because this bit here is heavy. And while I keep it on while I'm talking to you, as soon as I go to something else, I take them off because they're heavy.
Yeah.
That's a different story. 2050, Okay, we've had the Prime Minister this morning saying I'm going off to COP26 and I've got the plan and everything. But you're looking at 2050 in a different way. How, for instance, our holidays may change, how we may change what we eat. And it's quite frightening, actually.
Well, I think we're going to see some change fairly quickly, not because the government is saying, yes, let's go and go towards our target of 2050. A lot of businesses have been moving this way already. Now the government's come on board, and I'm not convinced they've come on board fully committed. They kind of sound like they're saying we're going towards 2050, but maybe they've got a few little hedges there in there somewhere. But let's ignore that for
the
moment.
Well, come on, you know politicians, let's face it. You and I were politicians. We know what it's like. So, as mayor and deputy mayor, come on.
So the whole concept here is that things will change. And I think they'll accelerate pretty quickly. So the first thing we'll see change is travel. We've been able to survive for the last year and a half without international travel. Some people are a bit frustrated by that. But I think we'll see a reduction in our international travel. 2% of all carbon emissions around the world are created by planes. Mm. If we can, say, for example, take shorter flights, we might start to fly in Australia for our holidays rather than going overseas. Or if we do go overseas, there might not be short trips. So I know people, and I've done it myself in the past, quick trip over to the US, spend a few days there, go to a conference, do whatever you're doing, and a quick trip back. You go, wow, I burn up a lot of fuel just to go for those few days over there. So you might have longer trips overseas, or you might negate those shorter trips and tune in remotely, for example. So I think travel will be different. I think we'll do more travel internally. We might do travel by camper van, maybe electric camper van, who knows. But I think we'll do more of that. You're absolutely spot on in terms of the way we eat. I'll get to that in a minute, though. But I think work from home. People have learned they can work from home.
Yes.
And I think we'll see that hybrid. It might be, okay, boss, I'll come in 4 days a week. The fifth day, I'll stay at home, and that's the day I'll do these other things and catch up on those things. So we'll see fewer cars on the road. Fewer cars on the road, less pollution generated by those cars. Fantastic. And then I think we'll see more bike lanes or more other methods, I suppose, to commute. So buses will get better, or our public transport might get better and easier. But those bike lanes, e-bikes are becoming very popular. So I think we'll see more people choosing on those days that they do go to work to go e-bike. And then food, you're right. We know that cows produce a lot of methane. Methane is a very dangerous greenhouse gas. I'm not saying we should stop eating meat altogether, but I think we'll see either different foods for them to eat. Seaweed, for example, is one of the ways they can eat food, still have nutrition, and actually produce less methane. But we might also see more chicken being consumed because that produces fewer greenhouse gases. Or lab meat. We've mentioned lab meat here before.
No, we did.
I don't want every farmer to come and ring me this afternoon and say, what are you doing? Tell me my business is out the door. Yeah. I think we'll still have a place for farming and traditional farming, in Australia in particular. We've got lots of land, lots of sunlight. But I think we'll see more and more of those other alternatives around the world. I think we'll see more EV. That's pretty obvious. That's really starting to take off the whole EV market. Hertz just put an order in for 100,000 Teslas. So when you go to hire a car in the future, you'll be able to hire an EV. That'll be one of the options you'll have there. And buses, I mentioned public infrastructure. There's 40 buses going in Sydney in the immediate future. We're talking about next month. That'll be entirely EV buses or electric buses, not EV buses, but electric buses. So there's a whole range of things that will change. And I think we'll see these changes happening very quickly, Richard.
I agree with you, and I think there will be a lot of change. And the other thing that was mentioned again by the Prime Minister this morning was the amount of solar power roofs we have in this country, probably the highest in the world, and how the government want to encourage people to put batteries into their houses and subsidise batteries, which I thought was quite interesting. Have we got time? Yeah, we've got time for a very, very quick one. The 20th anniversary of the iPod.
Yeah, so do you remember your first iPod?
Yes, I do, actually.
Which model was it, or which size
was it? Oh, I can't. It was a mini, I know that.
There's been about 17.
I think it was about 12, 13 years ago now.
Yeah, right. There's been 17 different models. So
really?
People have often had a range of different ones. I know I've had a variety of different ones for different uses. In fact, I used a couple at the same time on stage, one for riding my bike and one for just sitting around listening to it. But the iPod was released 20 years ago, 23rd of October 2001, so just a couple of days ago, 20 years ago. And everyone thinks that's what revolutionised the entire music industry, the way we listen to music. It wasn't really the thing that triggered everything that we do today. There were already MP3 players out. Creative Labs, for example, had an MP3 player out. iPod was a bit nicer, looked a bit slicker, like Apple did. But still, when it came out, you had to go and take your CDs, put them into your computer, use iTunes to get the CD from traditional format, the CD, onto your MP3 player, the iPod. And that was all a bit clumsy, a bit of a pain, and so mostly computer nerds did it. But in 2003 was when the world took off. That's when iTunes Music came out, and you could then go and buy a song for 99 cents.
That's right.
And there were 200,000 songs available on launch, and that sounds fantastic. There are something like 30 million songs available now, so 200,000 is nothing. But at the time, 200,000 songs. When Steve Jobs first launched the iPod, he boasted 1,000 songs in your pocket, which sounded great. Once iTunes Music came out, it was 200,000 songs in your pocket, and it took off. It only took something like about 3 years for the first billion songs to be sold on iTunes. So it really took off, and that's what changed the way we listen to music, and the way we still listen to music now all started from 2003 when iTunes Music took off.
Yeah, well, I've got to say, if we want to put a song on this computer, we go through the process that we do. 2000, you get the CD, you put it into the computer, right. and they put it in this. That's how we do it, to get quality.
Yeah.
Because we're an FM stereo broadcasting station.
Sure.
But, yeah, you're quite right. But, again, the iPod's been thrown at radio. Spotify's been thrown at radio. We've had all these things thrown at us. We're still here.
Yeah, that's right. And obviously what people listen to radio for is the music, but also the interesting chat by you and I.
Well, I suppose, I hope so. Anyway, I hope so. Matthew, always good talking to you.
Thank you.
Catch up next week with Tech Talk. It's coming up to 21 to 10 DCFM 88.9.